Welcome inside Historic Huff Hall in Champaign, Illinois for a top five matchup. The number one team in the country, Oklahoma, in town to take on number five Illinois. The Illini sit at 4-1 on the season. How big is this matchup? Well, let's take a look. You see Oklahoma first in three of the six events. Illinois, not too bad either, including first overall on the vault. And hello, everybody. Alongside Michigan's Brandon Burns, I'm Dean Linke. And really, Brandon, that last graphic tells the story on how big this meet is.
It really does. Oklahoma coming into this meet ranked number one in the country. They've got some massive gymnastics, but this Illini team has a lot of great young talent. It's going to be a good one to watch.
All right, Brandon, let's start with Oklahoma. Who are the Sooners that you have your eye on?
Well, the Sooners enter this meet ranked number one in the country largely due to people like senior captain Jack Freeman. He's an All-American on high bar, and head coach Mark Williams said he's a real leader of the Sooners team. His teammate Emery DeDanley is ranked number one in the nation on floor exercise with a stratospheric 15.0 average on that event. Look out for some big skills for him. And Ignacio Yockers is one of the best pommel horsemen, not just in the country, but in the entire world.
And Brandon, for the Fighting Illini.
Well, Tate Costa won the all-around a few weeks back at Windy City, only on three events tonight, but definitely someone who can have an impact on the outcome of this meet. Team captain Connor McCool is a phenom on floor exercise with an almost uncanny ability to stick landings. He'll be challenging DeDanley for the floor title tonight. And Ashton Anaya is the reigning national champion and two-time defending Big Ten champion on the still rings. When it comes to event specialists, this Illini team has some of the best.
And Illinois led by Daniel Ribeiro in his second season, replacing Justin Spring, who's now with Alabama on the women's side. You see, they had a great finish last year at the NCAAs. And then Mark Williams in his 25th season. Oklahoma has 12 national championships. Mark Williams has led the Sooners to 9 of the 12. Let's take a look at the scoring. Brandon, break it down for everybody watching today on the Big Ten Network.
Well, every skill in gymnastics is assigned a difficulty value. The more challenging the skill, the higher the value. When you add up the value of the top 10 skills in a gymnast routine, you have your total difficulty score. Then your execution starts at a perfect 10.0, and as the athletes do their routine, the judges deduct from that for any form breaks. At the end of the routine, we add up the total difficulty value with whatever is left of the execution score, and that is your final score.
All six rotations will be five up, five count. We'll start at the floor, and we'll rotate back and forth between the two teams. We'll move to the horse, then the rings, the vault, and so on. As we get ready to go, we start on the floor with Illinois. Amari Sewell, season high 13.35, career high 14. He had that 13.35 in his last meet.
And Amari opens up with a huge double twisting double back. You could have driven a van under that skill, and that's not an exaggeration. So much height and amplitude on that opening pass.
He's a junior from Bowie, Maryland, and Charles Flowers High School.
Relatively simple side pass there. Trying to avoid as much deduction as possible. On floor exercise, the majority of your deductions will probably come from the landings. So definitely not a bad strategy to play it safe on some of those passes.
Illinois has a team fourth in the country on the floor.
Nice combination pass there. Back 2.5 to a front layout. They changed the rules about a year and a half ago. You do not get connection bonus for doing two twisting skills connected like that. So he did one twisting skill into a non-twisting skill so that he got that connection bonus. Nice dismount, full twisting double back. That is tough at the end of a routine, and he's fired up for it.
Yeah, good aptitude on that last pass.
Absolutely. He's so springy on that event.
Colin Flores with a 13.1, as the two Flores brothers are here, two freshmen from Mountain House, California, as Flores lead off freshman. Again, Oklahoma number one in the nation and number one on the floor as they start with Flores, Colin Flores.
Colin has a lot of front twisting in these first couple of passes here. Watch this mount. Front 2.5 kicks out of it. for a pretty good landing. Just a little bit short, but not bad. Then he's got some more front twisting here. Combination front full into a front double full. Nicely done.
His twin Tyler also on the team.
There's a big full twisting double back. You got to be careful with those landings. The judges want to see you land in a perfectly upright position, chest up tall. It's a little bit of a razor's edge to really stick a pass effectively. You've got to keep your center of gravity low, but the judges want to see you standing up tall.
Flores brothers, part of the West Coast Olympic Gymnastics Academy.
There's that same combination pass that we saw from Amari. That back two and a half to a front layout. Triple full for the dismount, chest just a little bit low, small hop on that landing, but overall a good leadoff routine. Here's another look at that opening pass. 1.5 times around, and a small hop on the landing, probably only 1/10 of a point off.
A decent start for the freshmen, as Oklahoma always attracts the top gymnasts across the country. You open the show talking about Tate, not gonna do the all-around, that's part of kind of managing the season, right?
It is. Load management is huge, especially for your all-around competitors. Doing six events week in and week out, it's too much. You have to make sure that you peak at the right time for the postseason. Another front 2.5. That one really clean in the air. Whenever these athletes are doing those twisting skills, you want to watch their feet, make sure they stay glued together. And that was a nice Arabian half out as well.
As you're watching, you'll see some young gymnastics out there, as got to give Daniel Ribeiro credit, as he's kind of running a 10-ring circus here, in the sense some of the top young club gymnastics are going on at the exact same time as this meet, top five matchup.
That's right. And for some of these athletes, they're going to love that because there's more people in the audience, a little bit more energy, a little bit more noise. If you're a gamer, you're going to like that. Simple side pass again, but does exactly what he needs to do. Perfect form all the way throughout. Oh, and he kind of snuck that one around. You saw his knees bend just a little bit. He did that to increase the rotation. He was a little bit under-rotated on that first skill, but he covered up that mistake nicely. Won't be too big of a deduction.
13-8 season and career high for Tate.
And that's a tough dismount. Front double full at the end of a routine. You are just gassed at the end of that 75 seconds. Here's this big double flipping pass. Full in. I don't know if I'll count it as a stick, but it was awfully close. Watch this 2.5. His feet were just a little bit too far in front of him. You saw his knees buckle, so he did have to bend his knees to get it around, but great job handling that.
So up next for Oklahoma on the floor will be Brigham Friendaway, a junior from Cheyenne, Wyoming. He's part of 5280 Gymnastics. Still waiting for the score for Colin Flores. Friendaway went to Central High School in Wyoming. Here we go, Brigham Friendaway. 12.95 for Flores.
Friendaway opens up with a big double layout. Beautifully executed there. Double twisting, double back, stuck landing. Those landings are so important. If you take a hop or a step that is greater than about a foot, the judges are going to give you a 3/10 deduction. That one right there should only be 1/10.
It's too early to scoreboard watch, but we can tell you Amari Sewell with a new career high of 13.7 to open things up for Illinois.
And that's a great score, especially from your leadoff. Typically, you'll see your more consistent guys going up front and your heavy hitters with the big scores more towards the end of the lineup. So for a leadoff, a 13-7 is fantastic.
Tate also with a career high 14-2, so Friendaway will need to pick up some speed here. As remember, Flores started with a 12.95.
Triple full dismount. Very, very nice. Just a small hop on the landing there.
That's what we do! That is what we do!
That's what they do.
It is what they do. Consistent gymnastics has been the hallmark of Oklahoma for years. Look at this opening pass. Double layout. Perfectly stretched out in the air. No knee bend. Beautifully done.
Like he's been watching that quarterbacks documentary on Patrick Mahomes. It's one of his favorite lines as he's playing right now. Evan Manavong with a career high of 14-3. This will be his first floor of the year.
Really, really smart kid. He's a Big Ten distinguished scholar, three-time academic All-American. There's another one of those Randys. Seems to be a favorite for this Illinois floor squad. And that just dropped out of the sky. No hesitation on that landing. Every athlete on the floor exercise must complete what's called a non-acrobatic element, just like that V-sit right there, or handstand, or any combination of the two in order to get their full difficulty value for their routines.
Kansas City, Missouri, and Staley High School.
Same combination pass, back two and a half punch layout. You start to see a little bit of a pattern here with this Illinois floor squad. Seems like they've got a pretty cohesive strategy with some of the tumbling passes that they're repeating across the lineup. Triple full dismount. Oh, he almost stuck it. I think he managed to keep that back foot in bounds. It was close. Great awareness there by Manavong. Look at this, full twisting, double back, a little leg separation there, but look at that landing, a little smile on his face too. He knew that that was solid. Dismount here, this is a great angle. Did he stay in? Did he stay in? I think he did. Great awareness by Manavong there to avoid that additional 1/10 deduction.
So that'll bring up Matthew Burgoyne with a 13.95 career season and last meet high. So Matthew Burgoyne right in the middle of the five up, five count. There's no wiggle room. Whereas on the women's side, it's six up, five count. For the men, they all count.
That's right. You cannot drop a low score. And the fact that they're both on the same event, I think, makes it a little bit higher pressure because you see what the other team is doing. And speaking of what the other team is doing, that front double pike to a stick was gorgeous. That hop right there will be a 3/10 hop. Oh, and right there, he just got a little too bouncy. You know, the number one correction that any gymnastics coach gives is stay tight, squeeze every muscle in your body. But sometimes when you're landing on the floor exercise, you actually have to be more patient and allow a little bit of time for your knees to bend and absorb some of that impact. If you stay too tight on the landing, you'll bounce out of it like that.
Off that bounce, we're going went out of bounds. Remind everybody the deduction for that.
Well, it's an additional 1/10 if you have 1 foot out of bounds. It's an additional 3/10 if you have both feet out of bounds. The reason I say additional is because you still have to consider the deductions for the step or the hop itself. Back 2.5 dismount. It's a tougher dismount. It's 1/2 less of a twist than what we've seen from some other athletes, but it's a blind landing. Here's that double layout one more time. Watch his knees, just a little too tight. He's not patient enough to absorb that landing, and you see that back foot go out for an additional 1/10 out of bounds deduction.
So Michael Fletcher will be up next. What a story he is. 14-3 career and season high that he set last week, and he's, for lack of a better word, basically doing it with one arm. I mean, you explain it better than me, Brandon, I think.
Well, you see the tape on his shoulder there. He is quite literally taped together. He is a sixth-year senior, battled some shoulder injuries. Coach Ribeiro said that they reworked a lot of his routines just so he could get through them. So he knows as soon as he steps out here, he is really putting his body on the line, and that was an impressive save. You saw how low that front layout was, managed to get it around to his feet. Great air awareness. new one. We haven't seen that pass just yet. Back 2.5 to a tucked front full. Here's something we haven't seen so far as well. These are called Russian swings, something you typically see on the pommel horse, but that does fulfill the non-acrobatic requirement for floor exercise as well.
What a battler he is. Michael Fletcher feels like he's been around forever, and he has.
Absolutely. And Coach Ribeiro was so complimentary of this team and how hard they've worked. He said it's the hardest working team, most invested, most bought in team that he has ever had. And Mike's a great example of that. Triple full dismount, big step on the landing. That'll be a 3/10 deduction. But just to get through that routine at that high of a level with the injuries he's dealing with is so impressive. Look how low. He gave himself a haircut on the ground there, but he avoided touching the ground. It will be a low amplitude deduction, but he gets away without any disaster. And here's another look at those circling elements on the floor exercise. I can tell you from experience that does not feel good on the wrists, but it's worth a good amount of points.
Two thumbs up, which is always a good sign, as Emery Dodanley, or Jack Freeman rather, my apologies, Jack Freeman with a 14-4 season high, career high 14.75, last meet 14.2. As you see, Mark Williams from Oklahoma talking to the Illinois top man, Daniel Ribeiro.
And Jack is so clean on this event. I might have jinxed him just a little bit there. Big hop on that landing, but that double front tuck that he does, almost everybody else that you'll see do that skill has their knees apart. He keeps them glued together. Very, very impressive form from Jack Freeman. Big double twisting, double tuck. And that side pass right there is pretty unique. A lot of times you'll see guys angle away from the corner just slightly to give themselves some more room for a side pass like that. He goes straight down the side. Not the most difficult skills that we'll see on floor today on that side pass, but that's still a lot of gymnastics to fit into a very small space. A big breath before that dismount. 75 seconds of an all-out sprint, triple full, and he gets the stick. Almost casual about it. Like, yeah, I knew that was gonna happen. This is normal for me.
Fifth year.
Here's that triple full one more time. Up in the air. 1, 2, 3. He sees the floor so early. He leaves that arm behind him, opens up for the twist. And he's getting the crowd involved. He is loving it.
That's going to be a big score, I think.
It should be a very big score. A few more hops than I'm used to seeing from him throughout the rest of the routine, but that stuck dismount leaves a great impression in the judge's mind, and you get a 1/10 stick bonus.
Fourth in the Big Ten on the floor, Connor McCool and the 2023 Big Ten champ. Flashback.
And you can see why. 2.5 twisting double back. We've seen a lot of double doubles. This is the only 2.5 twisting double tuck that we will see today. It makes it so much more difficult. And as you can see, he is a sticking machine.
The anchor for the Illini.
Here's that 2.5 twisting double back. It's a blind landing, and somehow every time he always seems to find the stick. So impressive. A triple combination pass. That's new. I haven't seen that from him this season yet. A back whip to a 2.5 into that front tumbling steel. Now that right there is very unique. It's called a tenzica. He does a round off similar to what you would do going into a backward tumbling skill, but at the last second, he turns his body around, jumps into a forward tumbling skill. Really, really intricate stuff. He's gonna do it again right here. So it looks like a backward skill, but he turns around at the last second, so that was actually a front 2.5. Back 3.5 right there at the end of his routine. So much stamina, so much endurance. Here's the dismount. This could be big. Triple full. Oh, I almost thought he was going to get the stick, but a 1/10 step. Regardless, that's going to be a huge, huge number for Connor McCool in the Illini.
Just a ton of power for double sevens, and Connor McCool, fourth in the Big Ten, as we now go back to Dodanley, will be the anchor, leads the team with a 15.0 average, already had a 15.250. He's number one in the nation, and a career high of 15.250. That is big.
Any time that you have a final score that starts with a 15, that is something truly remarkable. This is a battle between Connor McCool and Emery Dodanley for the floor title here tonight. And here's why: double twisting, double layout. We've seen a few athletes tonight do that in the tug position. He does it in a straight body position, exponentially more difficult.
Junior from Canada.
He's going to do the same double-double, tugged this time, just opens up, drops out of the sky. When I say he opens up, that skill is done in a tucked position, meaning his legs are bent. He has so much time in the air that he actually extends his body before hitting the ground to stop his rotation, really gives it some flair.
Connor McCool with a 14.050, almost tying his career high.
It's a very good score. He had a few larger hops that would be some 3/10 deductions. So Emery's got a shot at the floor title here if he stays clean. Front layout to a front 2.5. That's big time at the end of a routine like this. Dodanley opening up the door just a little bit with these hops. It might come down to the dismount right here. Triple full, same dismount. He gets the stick as well. I think that might take the floor title today between the massive skills at the beginning of the routine and that stuck dismount. Look at the power here, how he just launches up into the air. Great form, legs together, knees were straight. That is tough. Here's the dismount, triple full.
Off to a great start here in a top five matchup. It'll be Illinois on the horse, Oklahoma on the horse when we return. Gymnastics on the Big Ten Network is brought to you by State Farm. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And we did not have to look far for our State Farm State of Success. Brought to you by State Farm. Last year, both these teams making some noise at the NCAAs, but Illinois, who fell to Oklahoma on the road during the regular season, actually finished third, essentially medaled at the NCAAs.
That's right, and when we spoke with head coach Mark Williams, he said his team is considering this a rematch, so they are motivated to come in here and see what they can do tonight.
Speaking of motivated, a season-high floor score for the Illini at 69.1. That means they lead Illinois, who's number one in the country on the floor. They got the big score by Dodanley at the end, 14-5, but one full point behind Illinois, as Illinois, that's the kind of statement you want to make, right? If you're facing a team number one in the country, number one in the country on floor, and you beat them on the floor, that's a great start.
That's right. And what really hurt Oklahoma were those two scores in the 12s. That 14-5 by Dodanley was huge, but you cannot afford a 12.
See the 14-2 from Tate, and then Connor with a 14.05. That's 69-1, a season high. By the way, friend the way, when you saw the Oklahoma scores, that was his career high at 14-3. So if you're Daniel Ribeiro, this is exactly the kind of start you want, right?
It is. You want to build momentum straight out of the gate, especially in an environment like this. Huff Hall, home crowd, great engagement, great attendance. The fact that the energy is on their side and the scores are on their side, that team is feeling it right now.
So there's the team total. One full point ahead, Oklahoma over Oklahoma, 69.1 to 68.1, as they move to the horse, where Oklahoma is also number one in the country. Illinois, though, is sixth in the country. They're third in the Big Ten, as you see Mark Williams. 25 years. Nice and relaxed yesterday as one of his four cats was hanging around. The cat got more airtime than he did on our Zoom call with him.
Hey, I don't blame him. That cat, that was engaging.
All right, so Kelton Christensen will get things started for Oklahoma, the number one team in the nation on the horse. He's got a 13.75 career high, season high, and guess what? That was his score in the last meet for the sophomore.
And your first man up on pommel horse is quite possibly the most important person in your entire lineup. Horse can make or break a meet for your team, and so setting the tone right out of the gate is so important.
Christensen, like Friend the Way, from 5280 Gymnastics.
And whenever you're watching pommel horse, the thing that you want to pay attention to is the hip angle, whether they're fully extended, flat body position, or whether they have a bend in their hips. And then, of course, the distance between their body and the pommel horse. And he's slowing down just a little bit here. He's got to get it over the top of the horse. Nice fight at the end, just a little bit slow on the dismount. They'll take a rhythm deduction, but nothing major. That's a great hit to start things off for Oklahoma.
So Kelton Christensen, the sophomore from Arvada, Colorado, Wheat Ridge High School.
And here's that dismount again. You see his knees are so close to those wooden handles on the pommel horse, but he handled it well. The last thing that you want to do there is panic and start moving your hands too quickly. He did a good job and exactly what he needed to do in that situation.
Vahe Petrosian will be up first for the Illini. He has a 13.5 season and career high, and also the same score he had the last time up. Petrosian up first for the Illini, the freshman, as they have a freshman to lead off and a freshman in the anchor.
That's right. The Illini have a very seasoned history of great pommel horsemen, Daniel Ribeiro being one of them. Said they call themselves the Pommel Crew. It was so important to him that he named his puppy after it. PK. And these flares are so dynamic. As a general rule of thumb on pommel horse, any skill that is done in a flared position, it increases the value compared to the same skill done with legs together. Oh, and he just lost his rhythm there. He has 30 seconds now to chalk up, get his composure, and get back on the event. Now, Dean, that fall is a one-point deduction, so that lead that the Illini had from floor, it's gone. And you see his shoulders just got a little bit off balance. Once you start leaning off to the side like that, there is nowhere for your hands to go. And at this point, it is critical that he minimizes deductions from this point forward. Dean, as you mentioned in the open, five up, five count. You can't drop the score. But a great job there, getting things back on track. Very few deductions on the second half of that routine.
Yeah, he came back stronger for the finish, and we'll see what that means for his score. Kylan Walker will be next for Oklahoma. He's got a 13.7 career and season high. His last time up in the last meet was a 13.6. Kylan Walker next to go for Coach Williams and the Oklahoma Sooners. He is a junior from Hercules, California, and he's part of the Head Over Heels Athletic Arts Gymnastics Program.
You see Kylan taking a few deep breaths here before the pommel horse. I would argue pommel horse is the most nerve-wracking event in men's gymnastics. We liken it to the balance beam for the women's side of the sport, because there's just so little margin for error.
Here we go, Kylan Walker on the horse for the Sooners.
This thing started with a nice scissor element, and this right here, a full twisting here for your second man in lineup, just shows how this Oklahoma Sooner team is pushing difficulty. Oh, a little leg separation there. Did a good job handling it. Not a disaster. Nice traveling element there called Tong Fei, traveling from one end of the horse to the other. Oh, and he's hanging on here. Big leg separation. He's got to get up to that handstand. He does a good job there. It was gritty, but it's always better to stay on the event than to fall. No matter how hard you have to fight, no matter how many deductions you give up, it's almost always better to fight to stay on there. Here's that dismount again. A little leg bend right there, but he does a good job of going up to that handstand with no hesitation, not using too much strength. All in all, it's a hit, and that is what you need.
Nice shot breaking down that leg bend, because he did eventually get up to the handstand, which hopefully will minimize his deductions as we move over to Max Farhadu. as Max Farhadu is a junior from Buffalo Grove, Illinois, and Buffalo Grove High School. Farhadu with a 14-1 career high, 13-1 season high. This is his first time to get in the rotation for Coach Ribeiro, who's looking on.
He was voted most improved by his teammates last season. That's a nice flop sequence on that one pommel. That handle on the pommel horse is barely big enough for two hands to fit on, so if you are off at all, there's just no room to correct. Traveling across the horse, that's a Magyar Savato right there, just the dismount left. And he did not do the pirouette at the dismount there. Normally you would see him do a couple of pirouettes spinning down the horse, so he will lose a little bit of his start value or maximum possible score. And you see a little room for error there. That horse is not very wide.
So Farhadu high fives from the rest of his teammate. Earlier we saw Colin Flores leading off for Oklahoma on the floor. This is his twin brother, Tyler Flores, who's got a 14-1 already in his rookie campaign for the Oklahoma Sooners on the horse.
Coach Williams said he loves coaching brothers. He said he's had about 10 sets of brothers on his team throughout his coaching tenure. He said both of the Flores brothers have exceeded expectations so far. Wondering why so many athletes are opening up with those scissor elements at the beginning. It's because just like your non-acrobatic skills on floor, it is a requirement for every athlete to complete that Russian sequence right there on one pommel, though. Very nice. And that was good. The handwork there. There's just not much space on those handles. And it looked like he was almost on top of one of his hands, but couldn't tell from his composure. Up for the dismount now. Little elbow bend. But makes it look very nice, and he's excited about it. Watch this dismount as he goes up for the handstand. You see his elbow bend. Oftentimes, that's actually the safe thing to do if you reverse direction in your hips. If you use too much strength, you come down a little bit and then press back up to that handstand. The judges will say that dismount doesn't count. You didn't swing to the handstand.
There we see the two Flores brothers side by side. Now we move back over to Illinois and Sebastian Ingersoll. He's a senior from Chicago, University of Chicago Laboratory Schools.
And he has two big skills right at the beginning, right there. That's one, it's a full Stockley, 360 degrees on one hand. There's the other, full Kier, 360 degrees on the other hand. Oh, and he was off on that. You saw him lean over the left side of the horse there. He's still off. He is fighting, and I thought he might have a chance at saving it there. He's stuck with that, but at a certain point, when your legs kind of get left behind you, you get locked up, you don't have the momentum that you need to continue the swing. And you see it right here. His hand actually spun across the surface of the horse and just not enough height and momentum to make it over the top there.
Sebastian Ingersoll will get back on the horse to finish off.
And that's a great dismount. Just had the dismount left. And that will be a 1 point deduction for the fall, which I believe will be the second fall for the Illini, so they really need a strong finish on this rotation to stay in the game.
Yep, they still have Hawk and Dang to go. First up for the Sooners, though, is Zach Nunez with a 14-8 career high, season high, and what he had in his last meet. He's third in the nation, averaging 14.525. Zach Nunez next to go for Oklahoma.
And Zach has a great look on this event. Watch his hip position as he goes into some of these skills. Completely flat. There's that full twisting Kier we saw from a few other athletes. Oh, and he has a little trouble there. Recovers it nicely, though. Watch the hip position on some of these swings. Just a little leg separation, fighting to stay on here. Needs to regain that composure. The last thing you want to do on pommel horse is get in a hurry.
It's from the Cypress Gymnastics Academy.
Just the dismount left. Flies up there, good pirouette. And that's a good routine. There's a few deductions scattered throughout that routine, some leg bends, some leg separations, but he stays on. And for the most part, when he has his legs together, he's so clean, there's really not going to be as many deductions as you might think on that routine.
Talented senior, third in the nation on the horse. Awaiting his score, Will Hawk, fourth to go. Season high 13.6, career high 13.96. Last week a 13.5. Will Hawk, fourth to go for Coach Ribeiro and the Fighting Illini on the horse.
And you saw that 12.0 for Sebastian Ingersoll. Will has to hit this routine. He's really been a rock of consistency for this Illini team for many years now. He needs to show that tonight. See those wrist braces on his wrists. Such a punishing event. This is really clean so far. Haven't seen any leg breaks, no knee bends. Flies up to the handstand, good pirouette. That is exactly what the Illini needed. That was a pressure situation. Will Hawk handled it beautifully. Here's the dismount one more time, right up to the handstand. Leans forward a little bit. He's a pretty strong kid. A lot of times you'll see guys, if they have that kind of angle in their shoulder, it might struggle a little bit to get to the handstand, but no problem for Will.
So Will, see if he can chase down his 13.96 career high. Talks about this young man in the open, Ignacio Yockers, with a 14.95 season high, 15.5 career high. As you see the event total right now for Oklahoma, they've got a chance to perhaps separate themselves a little bit from the Illini.
They do, and if they're going to separate themselves from the Illini, it's going to happen on this routine right here. Watch this sequence. Triple Russian around three times on one handle. There's the full twisted gear. Does not make it around. Now, this is important because this young man is capable of scoring a 15 on the pommel horse. We talked about how a score in the 15s is massive anywhere, but especially on this event. That can really swing momentum in your favor. You see right here, he just gets off balance, pikes his hips, and at that point, there is no chance of saving it. He takes the fall on the one-point deduction.
Yockers, a sophomore from Jex High School in Jex, Oklahoma, part of the Pride Gymnastics Academy, back up on the horse.
And the thing about this routine is there is a lot of gymnastics left, and that was a gutsy call. He repeated the same skill that he fell on, and there's always a conversation after you fall between you and the coach to say, hey, should we repeat the skill? Do we want to not repeat it and lose the difficulty value? Or do we want to repeat it and risk falling again? So that's a gutsy call right there. Yockers very composed. He's a veteran, especially on this event. Doesn't seem rattled by that fall at all. A little hesitation on the handstand pirouette. They'll take a slight rhythm deduction, but all in all, not bad at all. Look at this, the same skill, full gear, still relatively piked, a little off balance, but hangs on to it that time. And here's the thing about this one, Dean. His start value is so high that even with the one-point fall, I anticipate he'll still score in the mid-13s.
Brandon Dang will finish things off. It is worth pointing out that Max Faradu had a season high of 14.0. Meanwhile, Hawk had a career high of 14.05. And they really did need that with that 13 and the 12 in their five scores.
They really, really did. Brandon Dang, a true freshman, has the same start value, 16.5, as Ian Spurkey, who graduated last year, who is an Illini legend. And he barely hung on to that full Stockley. And that skill right there is so unique. It's very similar to that full twisting care, but he only goes three quarters of the way around, catches his other hand on the pommel, and continues into a flop sequence. Really difficult gymnastics.
Dang, ninth in the country on the horse, 14.45 career high.
And He's fighting here. You can tell he's tired. Does not do the pirouette on the dismount, but he gets through it. He looks over at Coach Ribeiro. They're having a conversation with the judge to make sure he received credit for that dismount. They're trying to see, did he make it all the way up to a handstand? It's close with that shoulder angle, but it looks like the judges gave him credit for it. There will be a decrease in start value because he did not do the pirouette, but he avoids disaster.
Oklahoma, the number one team in the country. Illinois, number five. They're on the rings when we return. Big Ten Plus delivers thousands of non-televised live events, access to next-day on-demand replays, multi-view to watch up to four games at once, and a 24/7 channel for your favorite school. There's no Plus like home. Subscribe and stream for as low as $9.95 a month at BigTenPlus.com. Oklahoma, with a strong showing on the horse, now has the lead, 136.75. Illinois at 136. Couple falls for Illinois, one fall for Oklahoma. But Oklahoma does enough to take the lead through two rotations. They were down 1 point after the floor.
Well, that's what those falls will do for you, right? 1 point off every time that you come off of the apparatus. It wasn't a perfect rotation from either team, but Oklahoma still came out on top. But it's worth noting there's still less than 1 point separated from one another, so anything can still happen from here.
So there you see the big scores from Will Hawk at 14.05, and also Max Farhadu with a new career high at 14. Take a look at Coach Williams and Oklahoma, what they did on the horse to take the lead through two rotations. Remember, they were down by that 1 point through the floor, despite being number one in the country on both the floor and the horse. Yockers with a 14.25 despite falling. That just shows you how much difficulty was in his routine.
It's honestly incredible that you can have so much difficulty packed into a routine and be so clean outside of that fall that you can still score in the low 13 or 14, excuse me, even with a fall. Very impressive from Yockers.
So that brings us to the rings, where Oklahoma is third in the country. Illinois is fourth in the country. Illinois also second in the Big Ten. Illinois will get things started with Ryan Vanish Thernaut. As Vanish Thernaut, a sophomore from Plainfield, Illinois, and Plainfield North High School, he comes in with a 12.8 season high, 13 career high. He got the 12.8 in his last meet for the Illini.
Ryan does not have the highest start values that we'll see on rings. The way to get difficulty value on rings is really through those strength elements. But he is very consistent and very clean with what he does. Opens up here with a back uprise to an iron cross. All of those strength elements must be held for 2 full seconds. And it's worth noting that if you do not hold it for 2 full seconds, it is an automatic 3/10 deduction. It's not like other deductions where the judges can say, well, it wasn't that bad, so we'll give them a 1/10. It's an automatic 3 if you have a short hold on the rings. Speaking of automatic 3/10 deductions, he's got to be careful with bracing his forearms on the straps there for that handstand and the press handstand he did previously. That's another one of those automatic 3/10 deductions that he wants to be careful to avoid. Giant through, just the dismount left. Full twisting double back, not the most difficult dismount we'll see. Only a C value dismount, but he does exactly what he needs to do and gets the stick. Here's a great view of that dismount. See him come off the rings. He's trying to look for the floor, maybe a little bit of an early twist, but you see how much he opens up his body before landing. That's really what allows him to get that stick.
Big smile from Ryan Vanish Thernaut. The leadoff for the Illini on the rings, as Oklahoma will lead off with Brigham Friendthaway. This will be his first time up this season. So Brigham Friendthaway, the leadoff for Oklahoma, as Coach Williams moves some things around to get Brigham into the rings rotation.
And a It's worth noting for Oklahoma, Fuzzy Bennis not in the lineup this week, creating some opportunities for other guys. That's a great angle right there of those planche skills. Perfectly flat. Very nicely done. Those planches have to be perfectly parallel with the ground in order to not receive deduction. Picked up a little bit of swing here. That does make these handstands quite a bit more challenging. He has to time this correctly to eliminate the swing. Still has a little bit. If you swing down from a handstand at the exact right time, it will eliminate the swing, and it is a deduction if there's too much swing. He did a great job right there. Completely stilled it out. Dismount coming up. Double twisting, double back. Very nice landing. Chest was up. Only a small hop on the dismount for his rings debut. That was solid. Here's that dismount one more time. This is an extra twist from what we saw previously. Two flips, two twists, and just a slight slide back on the dismount.
So Coach Williams with some instruction for the leadoff on the rings for Oklahoma as we move over to Logan Myers, 13.35 season high, 14 career high, had a 13.05 in his last meet. Logan Myers. So, by the way, Ryan Vanish Thernaut got his score increased to 13.0.
Good swinging elements from Logan there. Those two double flipping skills between the rings called Yamawakis almost become compulsory at this point. You do have to have certain elements included in these routines. Around 40% of the skills that these athletes complete actually are required. Now they get to choose which skills they do to complete those requirements, but there are four separate requirements in every event. That dismount, though, was gorgeous. Watch this here. It's the same double twisting, double back, but he finishes so early in the air. He has time to kick out, see the landing, but a nice smile at the end. He knows that was a great routine.
Yeah, solid dismount. Just a little bit of an arm swing and then slid his feet together. What's the deduction on that, Brandon?
Well, technically an arm swing is 1/10.
Okay.
The judges don't always take it depending on how big the arm swing is. But technically, that's a 1/10 deduction. You do have to click your heels together after landing your dismount, but that doesn't count as a step or anything of that nature.
This is Matt Burgoyne, 13-1. Career, season, and last week's score for Burgoyne, that 13-1.
There's that Yamawaki element again into a back uprise straddle L. Taking a nice deep breath in that straddle L. You can get a little bit of rest. It's not often you can rest on the rings, but that's one of those skills where you can catch your breath just a little bit.
Oklahoma number 3 in the country on the rings. Illinois number 4, so this should be tight.
Dismount coming up. First time we've seen that. Full twisting double layout and another stick. These dismounts are on point for both teams today on the still rings.
Oklahoma, 12-time national champ.
Here's that dismount one more time. Watch his hips. He's perfectly straight right there. He pikes down a little bit. That will probably be a 3/10 deduction for piking his hips down. But we got to think about that stick. He avoids landing deductions and the 1/10 stick bonus. All in all, that's a great routine.
Sebastian Ingersoll. Where's the number 7, Chicago, Illinois. Illinois, we believe, the only men's gymnastics team to wear numbers on the back of their uniform. It's all about that team concept.
That's right. That was something that was introduced by the team members themselves. They went to, at the time, head coach Justin Spring and said, we want to have numbers on our jerseys like some of these other sports. And a lot of times they have some meaning behind them as well. They really get into it.
.13.7 career and season high, 13 flat for the last time for Sebastian.
And in these handstands, you'd like to see the rings turned out just a little bit more so that you avoid touching the straps. Again, that could be, depending on if the judges feel like he's bracing himself on the straps just like that, That could be a 3-10 deduction, plus the elbow bend and the pike. So that handstand could end up haunting him in his score, but the rest of that routine was done very, very well. Here's that back giant one more time. You see as he comes over the top, he just overcooks it a little bit. Elbow bend, there's at least 3-10 on the straps, 3-10, the pike, maybe another 1-3. So that handstand is going to cost him close to a point in total deductions.
See how close it was through two rotations as we get ready to move to Adriel Perales Valencia, who is a sophomore from Tucson, Arizona, part of the gymnastics world. And there he is, Adriel Perales Valencia, third to go. Mark Williams gets him up on the rings and off he goes. He's got a 14-0 career and season high.
And you'll see as we get deeper and deeper into the lineup, the biceps get bigger and bigger, and you need them for skills like that. That was a kip to a Maltese, perfectly flat and level with the floor. The second skill, he'll do a same or similar skill, also a Maltese hold position, but instead of kipping into it, he swings into it. The second skill, actually a little bit more difficult, but some guys like to warm up a little bit with the kip, and some more trouble with the handstands.
Brandon, the triceps aren't too small either.
You got to be balanced. Catching his breath here in that straddle L hold. And even the skills that look simple on still rings, like that press handstand, they take a lot of energy. Dismount here, double twisting, double tuck again. Great landing. He was almost laid out during that first flip in that dismount and tucked it for the rest. That was a great routine. It's a great look at that dismount. See how open his hips are, and then when he really starts to wrap for the final full and a half twist out of the two that he did total, he starts to bring his knees in to increase that rotation.
So he was pretty pumped up as we move back over to Ethan Border. It's worth telling you that Vanish Thernaw tied his career high, and Logan Myers set a new season high at 13.75. So this is Border, 13.2 season high, 13.75 career high.
It's a great straight plans right there. Lowers into the Maltese. He does a good job of holding that. There's a unique rule on rings where if you do two strength skills and you directly connect them like that, if you hold the first one short, the second one automatically gets a short hold deduction as well. So on those skills particularly where you connect the two of them, you really have to be cautious of how long you're holding those skills.
Ethan from Knoxville, Tennessee, and Knoxville Catholic High School.
Nice giant swing there, similar to what you would see on the high bar, going in a big circle all the way around the rings. Dismount here, just a full in, but a small hop on the landing. Just 1/10 off there. That was a clean routine. Here's another look. Relatively simple dismount, and gymnastics is all about risk and reward. Do we do the higher difficulty dismount, have a higher start value, and risk more deduction? Or do we maybe play it a little bit more safely, but then get more or less a guarantee that there's not going to be any crazy disaster happening on the dismount? Ethan plays a little bit safer there, and I think it paid off for him.
So Zachary Marks with a 13-7 career and season high, fourth to go for Coach Williams and the Oklahoma Sooners, as you see the Perales Valencia score at 12.95. That kind of means Marks has to have a big mark right here.
He does. He does. Both of these teams have had some mistakes on their handstands, opening the door a little bit. That was a nice Azarian roll to a cross, that slow backwards roll up into the cross, increases the difficulty a little bit. And there's another one of those sequences, two strength skills directly connected, the straight planche lowering down into a Maltese, and that is tough because while you're moving from the planche down into the Maltese, you're still having to squeeze every little muscle you have to not fall through the ring, so there's just no rest between those two incredibly difficult strength skills. dismount, another full twisting double layout. That one, a little bit of form in the air, piked his hips, bent his knees, and then the big step on the landing. That dismount will probably be the largest point of deduction. You see that straight plans right there. A little shaky, but he does a great job of holding it. And then you see him lower down into that Maltese. He's still shaking the whole time, but just grits it out. Impressive strength.
What a great slow-mo shot from our outstanding Big Ten Network crew. Speaking of outstanding, Ashton Anaya, fourth in the conference, 14-8 career high, 14-4-5 season high. This man is legit on the rings.
And you see why right there, an Azarian roll back into the Maltese. That makes it so much more difficult because you're coming from underneath the rings. You have to go anti-gravity from under the rings to at ring height when you do those Azarian rolls like that. Very solid, strong handstand there. There's double flipping elements, Yamawakis directly into a backup rise Maltese. That's tough because you have to stop the momentum from those Yamawakis and come to a perfectly still hold in the Maltese. And of course, anti-gravity out of the Iron Cross. So strong.
Incredible.
And Dean, these routines, they're usually less than a minute, but it feels like it takes forever when you're straining every muscle in your body like that, so you are gassed by the time you get to that dismount. Ashton did a great job there.
Back-to-back Big Ten champion on the rings. The Illini, always the Lord of the Rings.
That's right. They've had a great history of rings from the Diab brothers, and now with Ashton Anaya, two times back-to-back. Really impressive stuff.
Cut some of that hair. That's less he's got to hold up there as well,
yeah,
Brandon.
You know, a little more aerodynamic.
All right. Last to go for Oklahoma is Tosh Haidu. As Haidu, a freshman from Las Vegas, Faith Lutheran High School, part of the Go For It USA Gymnastics. As Tosh, you see right there, following up Marks with a 13-2-5. Burgoyne, by the way, a new career high of 13-4-5 for Mark Williams. This is his anchor, Haidu, number six in the nation.
And it's not often you see a true freshman as an anchor, especially on an event like Still Rings. Usually you need a little bit of that time at college to get that strength and conditioning in and really build your strength. Tosh comes in with an incredible level of strength. Watch this. Elevator down, right to that Maltese, does a good job of holding it. And this is so, so dynamic. That bounce cross or Nakayama, he almost does it in slow motion. A lot of guys, they really bounce on the bounce cross. He does it so slow just to show off how strong he is.
Yeah, speaking of showing off, he's already won two ring titles in two tries.
Swinging elements there. Oh, just a little wobbly on the handstand. We talked about it earlier. Those simple skills on rings are not so simple. It takes a lot of strength, especially after some of those other advanced strength skills. Double twisting, double back. Big step on the landing, but keeps it on his feet. That's still going to be a big number.
Anaya with a 14-1. Take a look here at his dismount.
These are actually those Yamawakis, those double fronts in between the rings. So many guys do that because you do have to break up the strength skills on the still rings. You are not allowed to do more than three in a row.
All right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, the Illini, number one in the nation on the vault, Oklahoma, number two on the vault. Tomorrow, don't miss the top 25 women's gymnastics matchup when the Fighting Illini, led by their head coach Natalie Walsh, compete against Ohio State and their head coach Meredith Polisimi. Coverage begins at 7 Eastern only on the Big Ten Network and the Fox Sports app. Illinois led through the first rotation, but now through three, it's Oklahoma sitting at 203.3, Illinois at 202.8. We got a tight one halfway through as we take a look at the rings results for Illinois.
It is. We said in the open that this was going to be a match of consistency with this five up, five count format. I have a feeling whoever's the most consistent from this point forward is probably going to walk away with the win.
Oklahoma, third in the nation on the rings. Haidu with that 13-8-5 in the anchor spot.
And you see a few of those scores in the high 12s. That is what you have to avoid. And most of those mistakes came on the basics, on the handstands. They need to clean up just a little bit.
All right, we'll see the twins to start off, Tyler and Colin Flores, then friend the way, and Brezhnev and Dodanley. Second in the country is Oklahoma. Illinois first in the country on the vault. Tyler Flores, this will be his first appearance officially on the vault for the freshman. His brother behind him has appeared regularly to start the season. Good opportunity for Tyler.
That's right, and vault is one of those events where the nerves don't usually get to you quite as much. It's one skill, it's quick, and if you're trying to mount a comeback like Illinois, then it's a great event to be on because, again, they're only separated by less than half a point.
They just adjusted the team score, so 203.3, and Illinois adds on another tenth, 202.9, so it gets even tighter here halfway through.
Head coach Mark Williams said he loves competing with the Big Ten because if you're going to win a national championship, you've got to go through the Big Ten. Men's gymnastics is so well represented in the Big Ten Conference. He knows what he's up against if he wants to get back on top of the NCAA.
Here's the national rankings. They will change tomorrow. Oklahoma, number one in the country. Stanford, who won it last year at two. But then Chuck Chemelka has Nebraska at three. There's Michigan at fourth. Illinois at five. The Buckeyes at six. And Penn State at seven. All the Big Ten teams are in there. It'll be Tyler Flores with Connor McCool waiting as he'll be first for Coach Ribeiro in Illinois.
Just a reminder, the vault does tend to be a higher scoring event because it is just one skill, less opportunity to take deduction. It's all about big amplitude and great landings. And speaking of great landings, we got a stick for our first vault out with Oklahoma. A little bit simpler vault, two twists around. It's called a Kazumatsu style vault, but he sticks it beautifully. Here's the side angle. He does a great job of keeping his feet together on the entry. Now, that was a big squat. His chest was down low to the ground. He'll definitely get a deduction for that. But a lot of guys, as they come up onto the table, you'll see them split their legs a little bit. Flores does a great job of not allowing that to happen.
Oh, he held it. Well said. Here's Connor McCool, 14-6 career high, season high in the last meet of 14-5.
He's won just about every award that the Illini have, the Consistency Award, Team Spirit Award, Humanitarian Award. Really, really great contributor to this team in the gym and out. It's a 2.5, and we get another stick. We're going stick for stick on vault. Both of these teams want it.
That's what you're going to get when it's 1-2. Illinois, number one in the country.
A little bit more difficult vault here, adds an extra half twist, a little bit of form in the air, but look at him dig his toes into the mat and fight for that stick. That's going to fire up him and his team.
Wow, he got high, Brandon. He got deep as well and then held on. So here's Colin Flores, 14-4, career and season high, had a 13-6 in his last meet. How about Tyler Flores? His first ever vault, 14-3. That'll work.
It's a great number. Great, great number for his first time up. Here's his brother, the other Flores. A little bit more difficult vault. Oh, and you see him step over the line just a little bit there. If you're on the tape, it counts as inbounds. As soon as you go over, it's the same rule as floor exercise. 1 foot out is an additional 1/10. 2 feet out, an additional 3. You see him step over right there. A little bit of form in the air, but again, higher start value because of the extra half turn at the end.
So that's going to bring us back to Petrosian. Vahe Petrosian. This is his first time on the vault for Daniel Ribeiro.
Oh,
Petrosian, the freshman from LA.
Here we go. Another, a double full there. Hung it up in the air just a little bit. He stalled out his rotation. I believe his knee touched the ground. If so, that will be at least a half a point deduction here. Let's take another look. Pretty good form. You see a little leg separation there, but he just doesn't quite have the rotation. He does a great job of not putting his hand down. If he had put his hand down and supported his weight on it, that would count as a fall. With his knee, he might get away with just a 5/10 deduction there. It's borderline. We'll see what the judges do with it. It almost looked to me, Dean, like he was trying a little bit too hard to stick that landing. And sometimes when you try that hard to stick it, you end up under-rotating just a little.
See, Tyler Flores, 14-3. Colin Flores, 14-2. That brings up Bring Him a Friend away. 14-2 actually happens to be his career season and last meet score.
Friend away, when I've seen him vault in the past, does a great job at what we call spotting the floor. So he does that 2.5 twisting vault as well. And you'll see him lean his head over his shoulder a little bit, trying to stay having eye contact with the floor for as long as he can, just to get that visual and make it a little bit easier to stick.
Mark Williams, the 25-year top man, looking on. Josh Yee, his 6th-year assistant. And here we go.
Here's teammates in the background cheering him on. 2.5. Big hop on the landing. I think he kept it in bounds.
That's what we do.
I think that's the second time we've heard him say that. That's what we do. As great of an athlete as he is, he's just as good of a cheerleader. Let's see, did he stay in bounds? I think he did. That left foot was close. It looked like it was on the tape, so that is in. Here's another look from straight ahead. Definitely in bounds. See that knee taped up a little bit? These guys go through so much abuse on some of these gymnastics events.
Right in the middle of Coach Ribeiro's lineup is one of the best in the country, Evan Manavong. Top 10, in fact, he's 10th. He's 6th in the Big Ten. 14.85 career high. Season high, he hit in the last meet with a 14.7. Evan Manavong, next to go on the vault for the Illini.
And after that miss on the previous vault, they need a big one here. Oh, and he gave away a lot. Did a phenomenal job. Cat-like reflexes right there just to stay on his feet. But unfortunately, that deep squat and the big step right there will be a large deduction. Here's another look. And he's just a little bit off axis as he comes onto the table. You see his body is not quite directly over his hands. That sets him up to have that big step. 3/10 step and both feet out of bounds for another 3 and the squat. Not going to be the score that the Illini were looking for there.
Brandon, makes me go back to the first rotation where Oklahoma was number 1 in the country on the floor. Illinois was 4, but Illinois beat them. In this one, Illinois is number 1 in the country on the vault. Oklahoma's 2nd. Right now, Oklahoma, those are 3 solid scores right there as Friendaway with a new career high. And that'll bring up for Oklahoma Max Berezhnev. Berezhnev, a freshman from Woodstock, Georgia, part of the Georgia Connections Academy and Roswell Gymnastics.
And Dean, as they say, that is why they play the game. It is whoever is most consistent on the day of the competition. This is a different kind of vault. Your Chinko, 2.5, really, really clean in the air. With those Yurchenkos, you do a back handspring up onto the table, so that leg separation we were talking about earlier with the Kazumatsu-style vaults typically is not there. Watch the form as he goes from the springboard onto the table. Great job of keeping his legs together. Little cross in the feet, nothing terrible. But again, landing with that 1 foot out of bounds, there's an additional 10th right there. But all in all, that's still going to be a very high score due to how clean the rest of that vault was.
Big smiles from Berezhnev, who's got a 14.55 career high. Amari Sewell, 14.86 career high, 14.4 season high. His last meet had a 13.7. He'd like to pop it back up above 14 right now.
He would. He sat this vault down last week. He has so much amplitude, though. Watch this. In the stratosphere with the height off the table. He sat it down last week. No issues this week.
That was strong.
Very strong vault, and he is fired up for it. I don't know what the celebration dance is, but I'm here for it. Oh, the bowling. Nice. Watch the amplitude off of the vault table. He just rebounds off that thing, goes sky high. Beautifully done.
Yep, junior from Bowie, Maryland, Charles H. Flowers High School. I got that same walk-up, I have to admit. I do the little stutter step walk-up when I bowl.
Yeah, can we get that on camera for some B-roll next time?
Not too bad in bowling. So Dodanley. Emery Dodanley with a 15-2-5 career high set in the last meet. So he's coming in hot.
He is. We saw him on floor. We saw the power, how dynamic he was. He is so capable of sticking this vault. 2.5 twist, doesn't quite get the stick, but massive height, great form. That's still going to be a very, very big number, probably in the high 14s. Here's another look. Great form with the legs onto the table. Legs glued together all the way through. I think he was in meaning on the tape. I don't think he went all the way out, so he should be able to avoid that extra 10th deduction there.
I'm often surprised, Brandon, in how little they actually use their hands on this event. It's not like they're completely hammering when they're flying up there.
That's right. Well, the block that you get off of the table, the block is what we call that rebound as you spring off of the table on your hands. It really comes from your shoulders more than anything else.
Fletcher.
And the fact that he can over-rotate that vault on basically 1.5 shoulders is unbelievable. Because, again, that block comes from your shoulders. And so your shoulder goes through a lot of load-bearing, a lot of stress when you hit the table like that. So the fact that he was able to generate that much power is very, very impressive. Good vault for Michael Fletcher.
So for Oklahoma, Brigham Friendaway with a new career high of 14-4. You also saw Dodanley with a new career high of 14-7-5. That will really help Oklahoma as we push through four rotations. When we return, we will hit the P-bars, where Oklahoma's number one in the country, Illinois' number eight in the country. Saturday, stream men's gymnastics live on Big Ten Plus when the Fighting Illini face Michigan in a top five showdown. There's no plus like home. Download the Big Ten Plus and subscribe right now. Oklahoma, the number one team in the country with a new vault season high of 72.15. That included three career highs as we saw Dodanley get a 14.75. Flores, in his first ever appearance, the brother got a 14.3 and Friendaway with a 14.4 to lead Oklahoma.
Yeah, and Oklahoma really put on when they needed it right there, really separated themselves from the Illini, and honestly a missed opportunity for Illinois because they have the talent to stay right there with them. But 2.5 points apart, they're not out of it yet.
Meanwhile, for Illinois on the vault, Sewell and McCool, both with season highs, identical scores, 14.55. What does it all mean? Well, Brandon just alluded to it. Oklahoma at 275.45, Illinois at 273.1. So a decent jump for Coach Williams. There's Coach Daniel Ribeiro, who has had a tough go of it. His father was a 1980 Olympian all-arounder, John. He died of cancer in the fall, and he pretty much missed most of that time, was by his side, then left, and then came back again. And then Rochelle, his mom right now, going through breast cancer. They think successful surgery, just radiation. We send our best to the Ribeiro family. And, of course, we'll always remember the great John, who, like his son, was pretty good. See Tyler and Colin Flores. I mean, all five solid scores.
All five above the 14.0 mark. That's exactly what you want to see. That 72, anytime you're above a 70, you're doing pretty good. But on vault, especially a 72, that's a big team score.
So Oklahoma, first in three of the six rotations nationally. Of course, they're number one overall. They're also first on the P-bars. Illinois is eighth nationally. Alex Tapinez will start things for the Illini. It'll be his first time So Coach Ribeiro.
You see them prepping the parallel bars right now. These guys use a combination of chalk, honey, sugar, anything that they can do to get a better grip on those bars.
How about Coach Ribeiro talking about he could not have gotten through it without his great team?
That's right. Here's another good look at how they get those bars prepared. Every guy's unique. You know, they like the bars to feel a little bit different. But when you do those underbar skills, you've got a lot of weight going through the bottom of the bars. You want to make sure that you can hang on.
That was a great shot.
Nice Healy twirl right there. A little bit of a fight to get up to a handstand. Does a good job of not breaking his body position too much. Nice little sequence there. That was a Diamandov right into a Stutz handstand. Time to breathe through some of these basic skills before the dismount. Catching his breath, getting as much energy as he can for this double pike. Really nice form in the air. Relatively big hop on the dismount, probably a 3/10 hop, but overall a good leadoff routine for the Illini. Kept it clean throughout.
So we'll wait for his first score of the season as the leadoff for the Illini.
Here's another look at that dismount. Really good form. Legs stayed together. He just kicked out a little too early. Again, when we say kick out, we just mean that he goes from that closed, piked body position and opens up to stop his rotation. A little too early there, which is why he had that hop forward.
Freshman from Miami, Florida. As we now go back over to Colin Flores. His 14-2 as a rookie. Part of the reason why Oklahoma's number one in the country on the P-bars. Couple freshmen and two sophomores and a senior in the rotation for Coach Williams.
Gets things started here with a peach to a handstand. You really want to focus on having the arms locked out straight for those skills. He did give up a little bit of an arm bend there. That skill called it a pelt. Away from one end of the bars to another. There's another Healy twirl. We saw that previously, and he was a little bit off to the side on that. You saw that was a great angle there from the camera crew. When he swung down, he wasn't in the middle of the bars. He was all the way off to the side. Did a great job handling that, getting back up to the handstand. Just the dismount here. Really nice double pike. Really popped that up into the air. Small step on the landing. It's a good routine. Here's another look at that Healy twirl. You see him off to the side there, and that is tough because when you're that far off to the side, sometimes your hips can actually brush against your hands and knock off that base of support a little bit. He did a good job handling that. Judges probably can't see it that well from their angle. They're perpendicular to the bars there, but he did a good job handling that.
You see Alex Tapanez with a 13-2-5. Petrosian, his best score has come this season at 12.15.
And he's got some big skills in this routine. His dismount gave him a little bit of trouble last week. Be looking to improve on that today.
Freshman from Los Angeles, California, part of Gymnastics Olympica.
Come on now. Let's go.
Skill right here called a Hanma. From the upper arms all the way, one flip around to a support. There's that peach handstand again, little elbow bend, probably only 1/10. And here's that big skill I was talking about. It's called a Makuts. It's a Diamandov with 3/4 of a Diamandov, stopping on one bar and a Healy twirl on the way down. Did it very nicely. You're not supposed to pause on that one bar. He hesitated just a little bit, but it shouldn't be too large of a deduction. But that right there, you want to be very careful to avoid stepping or walking around on your hands. Every time you move your hand like that, it is an additional 1/10 deduction. Double pike dismount a little low. You see the judge put his hand up, say, hey, are you coming over the table here? Petrosian does a good job hanging on to it, stays on his feet. He will lose a lot of deductions on that dismount, but the fact that he stayed up on his feet is impressive with the quick reflexes. Here's another look. just hangs on to the pike a little bit too much, so his center of gravity was behind his feet. He had to take those few steps to catch up to himself there, but manages to stay on his feet.
Up next for Oklahoma, again, number one in the country on the bars, is Nico Hamilton. This will be his first appearance. He's a freshman from Grapevine, Texas, part of the TCC Collegiate Academy and Texas Dreams Gymnastics. Nico Hamilton gets into the P-Bars lineup for Coach Williams.
Coach Williams has a lot of confidence in some of these young athletes who haven't been in lineups so far this season. He says in practice, he instills a philosophy where just staying on the apparatus is not good enough. He wants you to hit a good, clean routine in order for it to count. And so far, the execution on this routine has been phenomenal. There's that tapelt again, all the way from one end of the bars to the other. Way through this routine nicely. He's got great form on everything. I haven't seen too many knee bends, any leg separations. If he can hit a good dismount here, this is going to be a great score just due to the fact that the execution is so good. And speaking of so good, I mean, a stuck dismount, you can't do that routine much better than that. Not the most difficult skills, but I can't see that routine being performed any better.
Call him up and he was ready.
Maybe that dismount chest down a little bit. The judges will take at least one tenth there, but he gets the stick, gets the bonus, and he's fired up about it.
So now Illinois with three remaining on the P-bars. They need a big score here from Tate, particularly after Petrosian with the 12-9.
They do. You get the feeling that Oklahoma might be running away with the energy just a little bit. The momentum is shifting in their corner, but again, it is too close to call just yet. Really unique mount from Tate. Not too many guys can do that. It requires a lot of flexibility to get your feet through your hands on the bars like that.
13.65 is career and season high.
Dean, one thing that we haven't mentioned yet about Tate is last year he was actually involved in an incident with a bus on campus, ran into it on his bicycle. There's another McCoots, really good job there. And the bus actually ran him over, crushed his leg, ended up making a comeback last season just on high bar. This year back in the all-around, such a resilient young man. Oh, and he was way off on that Diamandov. You saw his elbow buckle a little bit. His center of gravity was just outside of the bars. 30 seconds to remount. That will be a full point off. Here's another look at that mount. A lot of strength in the shoulders. Good flexibility to pull that off. And then you saw his elbow bend right there. Just couldn't quite get his hand back around to support himself on the bar. Unfortunately, he has to take the one-point fall. Dean, I'll tell you, those falls from parallel bars can be scary. They don't look like they're that high in the air, but when you're on one hand falling off of them, it feels really high.
Well said. As you mentioned, he has overcome a lot to even be here.
Here's the dismount. Double pipe, really nice amplitude on that dismount. Avoids deduction for the most part after that fall, but not going to be the score the Illini were looking for there.
Up next for Oklahoma, number one in the country on P-bars, number one in the country overall, will be Ignacio Yockers, who's got a 13.65 career and season high set this season for the sophomore from Oklahoma and Pride Gymnastics Academy. You see Colin Flores with a 13.6.
It's a pretty good number midway through this Oklahoma lineup. Ignacio, a little bit of a standout. Most guys that are as good at pommel horse as he is, they only do pommel horse. So for him to be in lineup on another event, kind of unique. Good Diamandov right there, full spin on one arm up to the handstand, does it again with an extra quarter of a turn, really fluid on those swings. The key to parallel bars is landing all of these skills perfectly in a handstand, not using any strength, not having to press the rest of the way up to the handstand. Ignacio's doing a great job of that so far. Just the dismount left here. Double pike again. Oh, and he stays on his feet, but just barely. I don't know how he reacted quick enough to stay upright. Very under-rotated on that dismount there. Opens the door a little bit. We've seen some mistakes on both sides here from the Illini and from Oklahoma. Look at how close to the ground he was. I believe he managed to not fully support his weight on his hands. That is the criteria for counting it as a fall. So they'll most likely take separate deductions there. One for chest down, one for the knee touching, one for the steps. So it, in all honesty, might add up to just as much as a fall would have been, but great effort and great fight from Ignacio.
Will Hawk will be fourth to go for Coach Ribeiro and the Illini. He comes in with a 14.366 career and season high. And make no mistakes, Illinois right here, right now, needs a big old 14 up there.
They absolutely do. There's a lot on the line right here. Opens up with a nice peach half. We've seen a few of those peach handstands already. That's the first one we've seen with the additional half twist. Does a great job of keeping those arms straight. We've mentioned that for a few of the other athletes. But that one was fantastic. Oh, and right when I'm complimenting his arms being straight, he has just a little balance check on that handstand. You can't give away a 10th right there. That skill, though, very, very well done. That's called a bobzar. From U.S. Olympian Raj Bobzar. There's that to Pelt one more time. Very fluid up to the handstand. This has been a good routine so far. This could still be a big number if he hits this dismount. Just a step on the landing. Not perfect, but definitely a shift in momentum that the Illini needed right there from Will Hawk. Take a look at this dismount. Cuts it kind of close. He was awfully close to the parallel bars there after that first flip.
So that's going to move us back over to Adriel Perales with a 13.65 season high, a 14.25 career high, and a 13.6 in his last match. Adriel Perales Valencia, as you see Yonkers with that 12.85.
And this is a big opportunity for Oklahoma right here. This routine has some big skills in it. Keep an eye out for a front uprise stutz. He's been competing that the last few weeks, as well as his dismount. Nice giant work. Oh, and he almost sits that down. We'll have to see if he fully sat on the bars. If he did, that's a point. Oh, and unfortunate. That's that front uprise stutz that I was mentioning earlier. We've seen a lot of guys do a stutz to a handstand from a support, but that's the first one we've seen from a front uprise. That's cutting it really close. It looked like he still had weight on his hands, but his legs definitely touched the bars. Here's that front uprise stutz. Just not enough power, not enough rotation. Ends up falling there. That could be two falls right there, depending on how the judges want to play it. And now it is absolutely critical that he finishes this routine strong, especially if they do. Oh, and that's a gutsy call again. Coach Williams has been making some of those gutsy calls lately, repeating the same skill that an athlete fell on. He wants these guys to get that experience to perform under pressure like that. He's got a really big dismount. You can tell he's a little bit tired here. This is big. It's double front, half out. And great job considering how tired he must be after that fall. Here's another look at the second attempt at the front uprise stutz. Very, very difficult skill. You got to think a stutz handstand is difficult enough on its own. Going from all the way under the bars to all the way on top in a handstand makes it that much more difficult. Good dismount there. Lots of difficulty. Double front with a half turn at the end. Only a small hop on the landing.
Michael Fletcher. What a warrior. Already told you the story about, as you said, 1.5 shoulders. He's 12th in the Big Ten, 24th in the nation, 13.6 season high. The anchor after Will Hawk with a 14.1, just short of his career high. Michael Fletcher to finish it up on the P-bars for the Illini.
And Will Hawk came through when they needed it. Michael Fletcher doing really almost a brand new routine. Coach Ribeiro said this routine has been reworked. He used to be really an underbar guy, meaning giant skills just like that, that put a lot of strain on the shoulder. He used to do a routine filled with those, now had to reorganize some things to make it a little bit easier on his shoulder. I'll tell you though, Dean, so far in this competition, you couldn't even tell me that Michael Fletcher is hurt. He looks great out there.
Well, and they've got a chance because Perales with 11-8-5, that's going to open up a little bit of wiggle room here as we head down the stretch.
Here's that dismount from Michael Fletcher again. Opens up out of it. Just a small hop. That'll be a good score from Michael Fletcher in the Illini.
Zach Nunez, the senior from Cypress, Texas, and Cypress Gymnastics Academy, is the anchor for Oklahoma. He's got a 14-1-5 career high, season high of 13-6. Sat out the last meet, sat out this event, would be a better way to say it. But yeah, right now he's got to make up for that 11-8-5 from his teammate right before him.
That's right. And then there was a 12-8-5 from Ignacio just before it. So they're trending in the wrong direction right now. Zach has an opportunity to bring it back for the Sooners. That peach handstand, a little bit of an elbow bend, a little struggle, has to use some strength to get to the handstand. Oh, and there's a peach half, and that was gritty. You saw the arch in the back, the bent arms, the fact that he was able to keep his balance there, really impressive. Zach's been battling some injuries of his own, not doing all the events that he's capable of. Peaking at the right time is so important in gymnastics. It's a long season. Gotta stay healthy for it. Oh, and he just missed his hand on the tabelle. That does count as a full 1 point off. That's a fall right there. Hopefully his finger's okay. You saw him take a look at it right after that skill.
Remember, no Fuzzy Bennis today for Oklahoma. He's fifth in the nation on this event.
Oh, and some more deductions on the dismount there. You see him look at his right hand one more time there. Hopefully he's all right. But definitely not the end to this parallel bar rotation that the Sooners were hoping for. You see the left-handed high fives there, trying to avoid messing with that right arm. Let's see if we can, and you can see it right there. His fingers come down on the bar instead of his palm, so he just can't catch it.
We have one rotation to go, but Illinois is narrowing the gap. We'll hit the high bar when we return to Champaign. Coming up, we've got you covered on the Big Ten Network for the major stories in college hoops, Big Ten basketball, and beyond. That's next on the Big Ten Network. Here at Huff Hall for the number one team in the nation, Oklahoma, and the number five team in the nation, Illinois. And check this out. This is how they came in, and yet who's ever in yellow is who won the event. So flip that upside down for me.
That's right. Oklahoma coming into this competition ranked first on floor exercise. The Illini end up taking the win there. You see the same story on rings. Oklahoma ranked higher. Illinois gets the win on that event.
So Daniel Ribeiro looking on. He'll watch Oklahoma go first on the high bar. Colin Flores with a 13-3-5. For the rookie, the leadoff. What a great tandem he has. As he mentioned, his 10th brother combination as part of his 25 years at Oklahoma. That's pretty awesome.
That really is. That's got to be such a unique experience to coach brothers like that. But Dean, look at the scores right here. Illinois back on top by about a point. It's really all going to come down to this last rotation. Anything at this point could make or break this meet.
Yeah, tremendous turnaround on the P-bars for the Illini to take the lead.
Nice pirouetting work there. That's called a ribalco. Full and a half spin over the bar. And on high bar, one of the most important areas is those handstands. Every pirouette like that needs to finish directly in a handstand. If you're a little bit over the bar, a little bit past the handstand, the judges put pen to paper and take a deduction. Dismount here, full twisting double layout. I don't know. It looked like he might have slid his feet back just a little bit. But a very clean routine to start things off for the Sooners on high bar.
Well, you can feel Huffaw starting to heat up here.
What do you think, Dean? Look at this dismount.
He moved
his
feet.
I think he slid just a little bit. That's only going to be 1/10, but again, he does not get the 1/10 stick bonus, so it's really a 2/10 swing right there.
The massive swing coming in the fifth rotation. Oklahoma, their lowest P-bar score since 2022. Illinois, a season high of 66.85. Hawk with a season high of 14-1. And as we begin now with Evan Manabong, that's why the Lionel are leading. Manabong with a 13.85 career high.
That's right. And you can hear the crowd in the background. Remember, this is a home court for the Illini with their fans. They're always so engaged, and they can feel the energy in Huff Hall tonight. Some really unique skills from Manavong, the one-arm giant going forwards. Don't see that too often. Did that to open up his routine. There's the same skill going backwards. Just the dismount left. Kept it clean up to this point. Full twisting double layout with a confident stick. Manavong, no hesitation on the dismount. Straight faced too. Watch this. Two flips, straight body, one twist. Just a little smirk.
Wow, so clean. What do you think? Can he chase down that career high of 13.85?
It's going to be tough. He doesn't have the highest start values, but it was executed very well. It'll probably be right in the same ballpark.
All right, 13.7 is season high, maybe more around that number. We'll wait and see as he makes the rounds with all the fans. Remember, the youngsters are here as well. They got everything going on at Huff as Brigham Friendaway with a 13.5 career high, season high, 13.35 in his last meet. See Colin Flores in with that 13.2.
He does a really unique release move combination in this routine, I'll point it out. When he gets to that portion of the routine. There's that one-arm giant again. Looks easy, but I promise it can be nerve-wracking at times. Here we go. Layout to Kachev. There's one. And watch this. Two skills back-to-back. Pike to Kachev. I jumped the gun on that one. Here we go. Straddle to Kachev. Ginger directly connected. Two release moves back-to-back. He will get bonus points for that. That was a very good full spin over the bar. That's called a quast. Landed right in the handstand. That one a little over. They'll take an angle deduction for not quite being in the handstand. Dismount, full twisting double layout, and he gets a stick. Oklahoma's not going out without a fight. That was a clean routine. Lots of release moves, good difficulty, and a stuck dismount for the end. Watch that. There's that straddle to Kachev directly into another release move called a Ginger. Wait for it. There it is. Dismount one more time. Two flips in a straight body position. Lands perfectly upright. No deduction on landing for that. Chest was up tall. Feet did not move. That's exactly what you want to see.
So that'll bring us over to Sebastian Ingersoll for the Illini. Trying to come up with a, I think you can call it upset, right? Number five versus number one. Ingersoll with a 13.55 career high, season high. Came last week with a 13.3.
And he has a lot of release elements in this routine as well. He just opened up with the first one, a Yamawaki over the bar. Here's another layout to Kachev. That looked like fingertips to me. Directly connects it to the straddle to Kachev. That was great. Here's a pike. Every single time you let go of that bar, it is a risk. You do get extra difficulty for those release elements, but if you let go of the bar and don't catch it again, that's a one-point fall. Full spin, one-arm giant. That's called a Zoli Min. This has been great so far. Big windup for the dismount. Double twisting, double layout, gets the stick. He's got to be careful. He needs to salute there. The judge kind of looked at him like, hey, man, where are you going? That was a great dismount, but they could be pretty aggressive on that deduction if they really want to. But watch this. High-flying stuff. Two flips, two twists, straight body position. Does not move when he hits the ground.
guess he spun with his back heels together, yeah.
He nodded at the judge, but they could hit him on that pretty hard if they want to.
He had it as we move to Kelton Christensen, who's got a 14-3 career high. Season high came in his last meet of 14 flat.
He's got a very unique release skill in this routine as well, one that you don't see too often. He's going to open up with it right here, a layout Jaeger. Don't see that often in men's gymnastics. With the Kovac-type elements, the Takachev-type elements, they really build into bigger and bigger skills. That Jaeger style doesn't have quite as much of a runway, so it's less common to see, but it's a really beautiful skill. Those invert giants he just did hurt my shoulders just watching it. Didn't seem to bother him too much. Really see as he swings through the bottom of the bars, he turns his body to the side to get that spin that he needs. Full twisting double out, another stick. It is Stick City over here on high bar for both teams. It's going to come down to the wire, Dean.
Yeah, the sophomore from Wheat Ridge High School just outside of Denver.
There's another look at the dismount, really flares it open on that last quarter of a twist there. Beautifully done.
Christensen, after seeing Colin Flores with a 13-2 and Friendly with a season-high 13-7. Ingersoll in with a 13-9. Now it's Tate again, 13-7 career and season-high. Coming off a 12, though, that he needs to forget about.
That's right. You have to have short-term memory loss in the sport of gymnastics. Six events is a lot. It's a long day of competition, and if you're still thinking about a mistake you made on another event, it's just going to mess with your head. And he goes big on this event. Watch this release move coming up. It's called a Coleman. Oh, and he was close to the bar. That's why he had to bend his elbows. Did a great job just catching it. He almost put his face on the bar. A little close on that Kovacs, too. Nice in-bar element here. The jam. Giants, here we go, winding up for the dismount. Tate Costa in the air, two flips, one twist. I think that's the first dismount that hasn't been stuck just yet, but still gets away with probably only a one-tenth hop. Watch how close he is to the bar on this Coleman. He let go of the bar just a little bit too early. Watch just a few inches between his face and that steel bar that's about 9 feet up in the air. Nerve-wracking stuff, handles it like a pro.
How about that shot with Oklahoma's coach looking on at the opposition? He is calm as a cucumber, Mark Williams. He's got a record of 572, 51, and 1 for a 92% career record. He's won 9 national titles. He won 4 in a row from 2015 to 2018. Illinois won one in 2012. They've got 10 total. They won a bunch in the early, early days of men's college gymnastics. But make no mistake, the high bar for Justin Spring when he first took over, they were unbelievable.
That's right. That was Justin's event. He was an Olympian, did phenomenal gymnastics on that apparatus. Jack Freeman right here has the same skill. The Coleman, he was also a little too close to the bar. Ends up swinging back down. That'll be a 5-tenth deduction at least.
That could be it.
It could be.
Freeman and Dodanley are tied for third in the nation, but Freeman, that'll be a major penalty, no?
It will, and that's very uncharacteristic for Jack Freeman. He's a captain, he's a leader on this team, very rarely gets rattled in pressure situations. It was an uncharacteristic mistake.
Freeman with a 14.5 career high, season high of 14.25.
He's been clean ever since then. Let's see how he handles the dismount. Big tap, full twisting double layout, and another stuck landing for the Sooners. You can tell the look on his face, though, not excited about the way that that routine went. Here's another look at that Coleman. Same double twisting, double back full twist over the bar. And you saw when he tried to grab the bar, he kind of hit the bar with his wrists, not his hands. Made it very difficult to get back over. And you see a little bit of disappointment after that routine for Jack Freeman.
Fifth year from Texas, Cypress Woods High School and Cypress Gymnastics Academy. As we work our way back over to the Illini, and Ryan Vanish Thernaut, who's the sophomore from Plainfield, Illinois, Plainfield North High School. He comes in, Brandon, with a 13-8 season and career high.
He has a lot of potential on this event. Needs to make sure that he hits those handstands. Last week, a little flat on some of those pirouetting elements. Opens things up with the Yamawaki. There's a top half. Again, just a little bit flat, meaning not quite in the handstand, a little bit over. That's a great layout to Kachup, though. Good amplitude. There's another one in the straddle position. And at this point, the Illini just need to hang on, avoid any major breaks. Finish there, not for the dismount. Full twisting double layout, a pretty big hop backwards. But that's still going to be a good score. Not the most difficult gymnastics we've seen on high bar today, but very, very clean. Here's another look at the dismount. High flying stuff, a little bit too high flying. Over rotated, takes a good 3/10 hop backwards, but all in all, very little deduction to pick from in that routine.
Just goes with Van on the back. Vanish Thernaut. Ryan Vanish Thernaut. Fourth in the rotation for Coach Ribeiro. And here we go. Emery Dodanley, like Freeman, tied for third in the nation. A 14.35 career high. Hit his season high last week of a 14.15. Here's what we know so far. Oklahoma with a 12.85, a 13.9. Friendaway with a season high 13.7. Flores with a 13.2. And Dodanley, last to go for Oklahoma, needs a monster score here, I think.
And he can get it. Buckle up, folks, because this routine is dynamic. There's big gymnastics, probably some of the biggest skills that we have seen all day. Watch this first release element. High flying, full twisting double layout over the bar. That's called a casina. He's not done yet. He'll do the same skill in a tuck position. Here's the Coleman. Great job on that. Caught at the perfect distance from the bar for a great giant out of it. Still flying. Got the straddle to Kachev right there. One more sequence of release moves to go. There's the pike to Kachev. Very nice pirouette sequence, the Rabalco. Just the dismount left. Double twisting, double layout. Small step on the landing. But what a power-packed routine. Look at the dismount. Two flips, two twists, laid out position. Small step, but a more difficult dismount than we've seen from most today. And he's fired up. The team's fired up. That's the kind of guy that you want as your anchor, especially in a pressure situation like this. Dodanley does not back down. He is aggressive no matter what.
Logan Myers, the anchor. He's sixth in the nation. Remember, Freeman and Dodanley for Oklahoma are third in the nation. Logan Myers, third in the Big Ten, 14-1 career and season high. Logan Myers, the anchor for the Illini. He could win it right here for Illinois.
And this competition will come down to this routine. He doesn't need to be perfect, but he does need to stay on the bar. He's got a big release move right here. Layout to Kachev. He's so aggressive with the taps, the way that he uses his body to bend the bar and launch him over the bar just like that. Two Takachevs directly connected with one another. Huge flying giant, similar to Dodanley in his style of gymnastics. He's aggressive. He could be one dismount away from an upset. Full twisting double layout.
They did it, I believe.
3/10 of a point step, but I think that will be enough. Myers certainly thinks so.
Daniel Ribeiro saw his team finish third last year in the NCAA's, one in front of Oklahoma. And just that little step back there from Myers.
What a night in Huff Hall, taking down the number one team in the country at home in front of this crowd.
And this after being way behind, I mean, really through four rotations, the P-bar is a tremendous swing and then steady and smooth on the high bar.
And I'll be honest with you, Dean, that is great coaching from head coach Dan Ribeiro. You cannot ever give up, regardless of if you're up a few points, down a few points. It is not over until the last routine, and they proved it today.
Huff Hall. I think they know what they've done here.
The word we're getting is Mark Williams is going over a score with the judges.
Coach Williams does have the ability to challenge a score. You can't challenge the execution score, but you can challenge difficulty. So if he feels they didn't give one of his athletes the proper start value or difficulty value, he can challenge that.
13-7 for Logan Myers.
The Illini certainly seem to think that they've won it.
So much history at Huff Hall.
That's right. Coach Ribeiro said it's one of his favorite venues. He's competed there more than anywhere else in his career. Really holds a special place in his heart, as I'm sure it does for the rest of this Illini team.
Illinois came in as the number five team in the country. Oklahoma came in as the number one team in the country. But guess what? Illinois, led by their head coach, Daniel Ribeiro. Daniel, through four rotations, it wasn't looking so hot, but what a tremendous push on the P-bars. And then you close it out with consistency. This is a massive victory for your program, sir.
Yeah, man, this was an incredible meet. I mean, we weren't perfect throughout. But the guys kept fighting. They never gave up. They never let the momentum sway. And that's why we were able to come out on top. Just never, never give up, no matter what.
Coach, this is Brandon Burns. Congratulations on the upset. What does this victory mean for the rest of your season?
This is massive. I mean, this gives us the belief that we need, that we can beat any team in the country. We got a big meet coming up next week against Michigan. We got to carry this right through into next week. We got some fixes that we definitely have to make if we're going to want to do that next week. But this is going to give us the motivation, the belief that we can get it done.
Coach, with the passing of your father and now your mom, we're sending our prayers to her. Your team was there for you. I wanted you to touch on that a little bit, Coach.
Yeah, I mean, these guys are everything to me. Because of how they were able to come together during that time for me is why we're able to be so successful right now. It also gave me the ability to be with my family during that time. And they're just so special to me. They have my back. I have their back. And it's just a great environment that we got here.
And it's part of the reason why you just knocked off the number one team in the nation. Coach, congratulations. You got it done at Huff Hall. Go enjoy it with
Thank
your
you.
Team, okay?
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
All right, Daniel Ribeiro. Take a look at the high bar scores. What a great man Daniel is.
Such a great guy. And you can feel the team spirit, that camaraderie, the emotion through the camera there as Coach was talking about his team. What a great high bar rotation, too. 67 is really solid for high bar. There's a lot of room for deduction on that event with all the angle deductions that judges can take. So very strong showing on that event from the Illini.
13-9 from Ingersoll was huge. Take a look at the high bar scores for Oklahoma. Finished with a 14.
And Oklahoma actually beat the Illini on that event. Illinois was just a little bit too far ahead for them to catch. You mentioned that 14.0 from DeDanley. Fantastic score for them, as well as a 13.9 from Christensen.
Coach Williams did have one scoring adjustment, but the Illini still get the win. It's the 10th time in nearly 70 contests that Illinois has knocked off Oklahoma. This time, it's number one Oklahoma going down by a score of Illinois 407.2 with the win. I want to thank Jim Ressler, Jeff Clark, Britt, and the rest of our crew. For Brandon Burns, I'm Dean Linke saying good night. From Champaign. Don't forget, coming up next, it's Big Ten basketball and beyond. Congratulations again. Illinois beats number one Oklahoma.